I'm so pleased to see everyone. Thanks for coming to my panel. I'm always glad to be at MAGFest. This is a beautiful area of the country. My husband and I stayed with friends last night in Baltimore, and we drove down this morning. I was in Baltimore, yes. And we drove down this morning. Tuesday night, we went to the Capitals game against the Kings. The Caps won. And there was a fist fight on the ice. So John and I feel that we had the total hockey experience. So, this is the Ellen McLain Q&A. So I see a microphone right there for people to ask questions. I say we get started. Who would like to ask a question? All right, come to the microphone.
Will you sing Still Alive with me?
Sure. Are you ready? And everyone else can join in too. This was a triumph.
I'm making a note here, huge success. It's hard to overstate my satisfaction. Aperture science. We do what we must because we can. For the good of all of us, except the ones who are dead. But there's no sense crying over every mistake. You just keep on trying till you run out of cake. And the science gets done and you make a neat gun for the people who are still alive.
Oh, very nice. What is your name? What is your name?
Johnson.
Say it again.
Johnson.
Johnson. Well, I'm so pleased to meet you, and you have a beautiful voice. I thought that was a nice way to start. Oh, I see someone coming over to the microphone.
Hello.
What's your name?
Amanda.
Oh, yes, Amanda. I met you earlier. I met Amanda. So, I hear you're a singer, Amanda. Someone came by later and told me that you're a singer and that you're also interested in getting into voice acting. Am I correct in that?
Yes, but I thought this was your Q&A.
No. Now, I always ask questions.
Okay.
So, please ask your question and then I may extrapolate.
Well, my first question was going to be if you've ever sung anything in the Baroque era?
Yes, I've sung a lot of Handel.
Okay.
And I've sung a composer named Hasse, H-A-S-S-E, who was a very famous opera composer. And of course, you know, nobody does his music now unless you just want to do a lot of coloratura. And so I did some of his music, and you know, Bach. I've done a lot of Bach.
Okay.
And I have a choir job. I'm the soprano section leader of a church choir, and I've had the same job for 22 years. And we do a lot of Bach in the church choir. And of course, I sang a lot of Bach at school years ago.
Okay.
And do you sing Bach?
I do.
So, what are you working on right now?
Well, for MAGFest, I was trying to sing a piece from Final Fantasy VI. I wasn't quite sure if...
Well, I would love to hear you sing, and if you and so you can have good posture if you want to just...
Oh, it's totally not ready. I couldn't find a pianist, I'm sorry.
Pick up the microphone. Just do a little bit of it. Do you need, I can play a note on my little keyboard on my phone. Do you need a note?
Well, now I magically can't remember how it goes. You guys are making me nervous.
So hang on a second. I have this wonderful little keyboard. My husband, I really don't understand technology, but I have the mini piano app.
Oh, God.
It's coming up. Mini piano.
Sure.
What do you need? That's enough.
You can look up whatever.
I have the Italian one.
Gigi.
Can I grab my phone and, like, give me, like, 4 minutes?
Absolutely. Go grab your phone.
Okay.
So Amanda will be back with us in just a moment, but I'll talk about, because I knew that Amanda wanted to ask me a question about how I got from singing opera into, and singing classical music into voice acting. And, I was always a singer and trained to be a singer, and it was my husband, John Patrick Lowry, who, when we moved to Seattle in 1989, he immediately got a voice demo and kept telling me to get one, and I didn't, and didn't, and didn't, and didn't. And then finally in 2002, I did get a voice demo, and I started to get work. So, come on back, Amanda.
To open the PDF. I got this on Monday. Hold on. Oh, God.
So just take your time to find it. So I'm assuming this is a PDF. Is this the accompanying track that you have?
I do not have an accompanying track, no. If there's a pianist out there that wants to meet with me later, I'd super love you.
Bach is very difficult to sing, actually, in my opinion, because his music is more complicated than Handel's. Handel was a tunesmith, and they both died in 1750. That's the famous year, 1750. So a lot of people who like early music say, I don't like anything after 1750. Because that's the year that Bach and Handel died.
Well, I have an error, but I think I can remember the tune now, so.
Okay.
I'm so sorry. Study with anyone for the past year due to getting a full-time job, but I was studying under someone named John Olland. She was known at Hood College, and I'll be restarting voice lessons as of next month.
So may I ask, I'm 63, how old are you?
I just turned 24 in January.
24?
Yes.
Well, you're a very good age, and I always tell people that my high school students, I like to see them every week. Mm-hmm. But at your age, I would say every 2 or 3 weeks.
Yeah, that's what.
Yeah. So don't feel like you have to go every week, because it's expensive. Mm-hmm. And I also feel like once a week for someone your age and older is almost too much information. Because you want to go to the lesson, you want to take the information, and you want to work with it for a couple of weeks at least.
Yeah.
Before, going back and seeing, seeing what your progress is, seeing how this information has worked for you.
Okay.
So, but I think that, you know, Bach and Handel, particularly Handel, is very good music for voice building. And I always have my students who are serious. I have a lot of students who only sing music theater, but my serious students, I always have them do Handel. I'm thinking of one student right now. She's 18 and she's looking at colleges. But, you know, she's sung Handel, she's sung Mozart, she's sung the Italian art song, you know, Caro mio bene.
Oh, I've done that one.
Everyone knows Caro mio bene.
Yeah, of course.
You know, and that repertoire. And the other thing is if you want to build your voice, get yourself into a community chorus or a church choir or something where you are singing, where you have to sing regularly.
I'm actually the head soprano in an early music ensemble.
Fabulous. So. And how often do you all rehearse?
Once a week.
Yeah, that's great. Because, you know, you have to sit there, you have to be sure your posture is good, you have to be sure your breathing is working, and you have to sight read. And that, and it's excellent practice on sight reading. Well, yeah. Amanda, thank you for singing for us.
Thank you.
I just want to teach people how to sing. So, and what is your name?
Josh.
Yes, Josh.
I met you just a little
bit
ago.
Yes, I met you at our table.
Quick question. What is your favorite language to sing in?
Well, the easiest language to sing in is Italian. That is the easiest language to sing in. You know, Spanish is actually easy to sing in as well because Spanish and Italian are called phonetic languages. They are pronounced the way they look. So if you have an L and an A, it's just la. You know, in English, if a word starts with L and A, like L-A-K-E, it's lake instead of lake, you know. So English is not a phonetic language. So English is actually very difficult to sing in. So I like singing in Italian the best. When I work with my young voice students, the most difficult thing is to teach them how to sustain a note on an English word. For example, love is always a very popular word in English songs. And my students will start out doing something like, love. And I say, no, what is the primary vowel that you need to sing on? It's ah. Love. Sounded like love, doesn't it? But you don't go through, because love actually has a diphthong in it. Mm-hmm. So I love singing in Italian. Yeah, yeah. Did you have another question, Josh?
Nope, that was it.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Hi, what is your name?
I'm Olivia.
Oh, hi. Olivia is a beautiful name.
Thank you.
So what did you want to ask?
I wanted to ask whether you had a favorite piece or a favorite overall score from a video game and what that was.
Well, I'm an old lady. So I honestly don't know that many video games except the ones I was in. And, you know, for Portal, I loved singing Still Alive. For Portal 2, Want You Gone, and the Turret Opera. I love the Turret Opera. Caro ben, caro mio ben. You know, Mike Moraski wrote that. And then Lego Dimensions is a game that was released in September, and Jonathan Colton wrote another song for it called You Wouldn't Know. And GLaDOS sings it because there's a portal level in Lego Dimensions. And GLaDOS gets to meet Batman. And so in this song, she's talking to the player, and she's saying, well, you know, Batman, he's a good friend of mine, but you wouldn't know. You know, she's name dropping. So, I love all the music in Portal 2. I think Mike Moraski did a great job. You know, I love Potato's Lament in Portal 2, which is sort of a place saver. You know, you get to hear Potato's Lament. And I love that melody. You know, do, 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 do. You know, and the little turrets are just making their little flute noises. But the wonderful thing is, you know, I know there are several panels this weekend about composing for video games. Are you a composer, Olivia?
I'm not a composer, but I hang out with the Washington Metropolitan Gamer Symphony Orchestra, and they have a lot of composers in there who are awesome people.
Yes. You hang out with them.
I hang out, and sometimes I go to rehearsals, you know.
Uh-huh.
But, yeah.
Well,
they'll probably be there.
I'm sure they know much more about it than I do. Well, thank you for your question. Was there anything else?
No, thank you.
Okay, thanks, Olivia.
Yeah.
And what is your name?
I am Mike, and I'm losing my voice today.
Oh, Mike, I'm sorry. You can pick up the microphone if you want to. Yeah.
I'll just bring it down.
Okay.
And I was just wondering, has Valve contacted you for any additional voice work after the events of Portal 2? Because
well,
we all know they
can't
count
number
to three.
Three, I'll tell you.
Okay.
But I will tell you that Jay Pinkerton, who is one of the writers for TF2, Team Fortress 2, has said that, well, I'm going to get this wrong, but there's been competitive gaming on Team Fortress 2 for a while, and in his email to us, he said that's going to be legitimized, which means I don't know what, but I think it might mean some more voice work for that skinny old bitch. Over time. I'm hoping. So I don't know. But you know, Valve is so nice to let me out. You know, they gave permission for Legos to have a Portal level. And they said, yeah, but you gotta hire Ellen. So I'm, you know, anytime they want to do that, it's fine with me. So, does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you very much.
Oh, and I should tell you, actually, John and I, John Patrick Lowry, my husband, voice of the sniper, also in Team Fortress 2 and a bunch of other stuff, there's going to be a game announced next week from Paranoid Production. I love Paranoid Productions, and the producer is Richard Rouse, a man named Richard Rouse, and a new game is going to be announced next week, and John and I are the two voice actors on that game, and it's dark.
Thank you very much.
So stay tuned. That'll be announced next week. Thank you so much. Hello, and please, may I hear your name?
Micah.
Micah.
Might have a hard time seeing as that guy in front of me was Mike.
Oh, okay. Mike's not the same thing.
Also, I'm going to be smart and pick it up.
Okay, you are?
Anyway, it was interesting thinking, seeing as almost every single voice that you've done for anything has been a computer, with the exception of like two or three, how is it knowing that you're voicing some of the most loved to be hated characters ever in video games?
It's never ceases to amaze me. Just never ceases to amaze me. The fact that I got to be GLaDOS was because I was able to copy the sound file that they sent. I came closest to copying the computer-generated voice. And I attribute that probably to my music experience, because when you're a musician and learning how to sing, you know, you're learning how to create sound, and I think my ear was good enough so I could just copy the sound. And I was just very fortunate. And I was fortunate to have a husband who made me get a voice demo in 2002. Because if I hadn't gotten the voice demo, I wouldn't have, you know, been asked to do the audition. So, I'm pretty happy about it. The other thing is because my young voice students and all of you young people and everybody in this room, I don't see anybody older than me, so you're all young in my book. I feel very fortunate that you all would be interested in something that I had to say or something I had to contribute. So it's just, it's all gravy, Micah.
Thank you.
Thank you. And you are.
I'm going to further confuse you. I'm also Mike.
Mike on the mic.
If I could, I have two related questions. You and your husband have voiced a ton of characters that I've loved from Dota and Team Fortress 2 and Portal. Who has been your favorite character to voice, and who is your favorite character that your husband has voiced?
Well, I mean, I have to say GLaDOS. Except that I have to say that the administrator is so out there and angry. She's a lot of fun to do because I really don't need any control at all. I can just be angry and irritated. So that is fun. And my the favorite voice of my husband, I've actually enjoyed the fact that he's all the citizens in Half-Life 2. Because I actually didn't realize that until he pointed it out to me. Because, you know, I don't play games, but I would sit with him. He loves to play Half-Life 2. Mm-hmm. And we'll go through and, you know, we'll meet a citizen and, you know, they'll, you know, hi, Gordon Freeman. Gordon Freeman, wow. And then we'll meet another citizen, and really the first time through the game, I said, well, who was that? I said, is that David Scully? David Scully is another voice actor, you know, in the game, somebody we know. And he said, no, that's me. I thought, oh. So I like it that I didn't even know that he was all the citizens. But he is a damn fine actor. In my opinion, John Patrick Lowry can do anything.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hello, John.
Hello. I was going to say, my name doesn't start with an M even, or sound like Mike or Micah, so you get a little bit of a break
it's
here.
It's John.
Yes, yes. So I guess my question would be, I'm a huge GLaDOS fan, like I told you earlier. Is there a specific part of GLaDOS's personality that you personally connect with when you're voicing her at all, or is it all just, is she just totally foreign to you and is it all just awesome acting?
That's a very good question, and she is not totally foreign to me. GLaDOS likes to get her way. And GLaDOS likes to give orders. And she does not expect to be crossed. I'm not going to go too much further on this, but she is a taskmaster, and I identify with that. So no, she's not foreign to me at all. And you know, when I did Portal and then I had to do Portal 2 and I was talking to my husband, I said, oh, I'm kind of nervous about it. He said, why are you nervous? You are GLaDOS. Why should you be nervous? And he was right. I am GLaDOS. And it's, you know, I fall into her very easily. I just kind of fall into killing you and giving you good advice aren't mutually exclusive. So.
Thank you.
Thank you, John.
Hi.
What's your name?
I'm Ladelia.
Ladelia?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm very pleased to meet you.
Oh my God, I'm really excited. I'm sorry.
You're not as nervous as I am.
Oh man, I've been shaking.
Look, I'm sitting here in front of all these people. Oh my God!
My questions are, do you have any specific lines from GLaDOS that you really enjoy doing?
Well, I love it when Portal 2 starts and she finally sees Chell again and she's, you know, pretty much destroyed, but she's back together enough to say something. And I like the point, oh, it's you. We're a lot alike, you and I. You tested me. I tested you. You killed me. Oh, wait a minute. I guess I haven't killed you yet. Well, food for thought. I like that one.
And I want to know, like, this is probably super random, and I don't know if you've gotten it before, but do you ever, just around your house, repeat lines that you've done from characters that you voiced in video games at all?
Well, funny, it's because it's the administrator. You know, Victory. You know, she's so easy for me to do that if I do quote anybody, you know, I sort of have to get very zen to do GLaDOS, but the administrator, it's like, yeah, she's right there.
Thank you so much.
Well, you're so welcome. Thank you.
Hi,
hello.
How you doing? My name's David.
Hello, David.
Well, Mike 1 answered my main question.
Oh, okay. All right, Mike 1.
Yeah.
What about Micah and Mike?
Well,
pretty on much. The mic.
Yeah. I'm mainly standing here because she is the biggest fan you've ever had right there. We came here.
Well,
just,
get up there.
Well, she can't. Her legs won't work.
Okay. Well, but I don't know. It looks like.
Okay. She's here.
She's got a companion on her shirt.
She might cry now. I'm warning you.
Really hard not to.
We came here just to see you. But
crying is the best thing you can do.
Yeah,
did you know that? Crying, obviously, it's cathartic. But, you know, I was in psychotherapy for 4.5 years, and my doctor always encouraged me to cry. So always cry. Mm-hmm. Everyone cries, and it's wonderful. It's a release. And it keeps you in touch with your emotions.
Get ready for a lot of it.
It's good for you. It's good for you.
One question I can ask is, how much input were you given on the pieces, like, say, during Portal 1 and Portal 2? How much freedom were you given for editing, personal editing?
Actually, you know, I've been asked that question before. On Portal 2, there was only one line that I told the writers that I didn't like. I recorded it anyway. Ultimately, they didn't use it in the game because I personally thought it was too mean. But you know, I'm paid to go in and record everything that I'm asked to, so I do. But that's the only time that I've said, guys, this is too mean. You don't want to do this. And they didn't. I was right. Of course I was right. But they direct me. At Valve, I've always been in the studio, you know, with the writers, and the writers know what they want, you know, Jay Pinkerton, Eric Wolpaw, Chet Falasek. They direct me, but then also the producer, Bill Van Buren. Sometimes, you know, Jay Pinkerton would say something that I didn't really get, and so, you know, Bill Van Buren would push the button down and he'd say, well, Jay means this. And so I would, but I, you know, I was directed on every line. And whereas J.K. Simmons as Cave Johnson and Stephen Merchant as Wheatley, they both improvise a lot. I don't really improvise. I don't improvise. And then the songs, you know, Jonathan Colton or Mike Moraski was there, and they also were very specific about what they wanted. So, and I like being directed. I like being told what to do. It makes my job easier. It's like, oh, you want this? Sure, I can give you this. So, did you have another question?
She's a blank.
I have so many when I came.
Well, okay, and you know, my husband and I have a table in the dealer's room, so you can always come by and
oh,
we could talk.
I promise you.
We could you know, just chat a little bit.
Can I hug you?
Well, sure, you can hug.
Right now?
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Oh, sure, sure. And I'll see you later. I'll see you later. So,
hello.
And you all. Did I meet you before?
Yes. Yes, we did.
Okay, but I can't remember.
Yeah, Aaron.
Aaron.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
As you can see, just being in your presence, many people are just awestruck.
Well, you guys, GLaDOS is just a wonderful character that was created. And you know it was created by some students. They were at a school in Kirkland, Washington, which is right outside of Seattle, called DigiPen. And Kim Swift, who I saw this summer again, and Jeep Barnett, who I also saw recently, created a game called Narbacular Drop. And that, you know, you may have heard the story, and Gabe Newell, it was a senior project, Gabe Newell saw it, it was presented, and you know, he was there to just, you know, give some input, and he hired them on the spot. And then they were told very low budget, so they were using a computer generated voice, and then it would cost too much, the copyright would cost too much to use the computer-generated voice. An actor was cheaper, so I got hired. And Eric Wolpaw and Jay Pinkerton, and then, of course, Chet Falasek for the multiplayer game. You know, it's the writing. You know, it's the writing. I couldn't have created a good character without the writers. It is the writers. And she is a wonderful character. And I'm very pleased that, you know, the player, the avatar, is a young woman. Chell, and I'm very pleased that the, I don't know, am I the villain? I don't know what I am. But that the villain, you know, they wanted to use a female voice. Because, and I like it that it's a puzzle game. I like it that, you know, maybe we lose a few little robots and a few little turrets, and the turrets are so cute. But nobody, you know, nobody gets their head blown off. And I like that. And I think it's, you know, I think it's a great entry game. Don't you think so, Nicole? Yes, it's a good entry game. Did I answer your question?
I didn't even get one yet.
You can see I have no trouble talking.
Well, that's a good thing. But my question is, do you sing at home? And if so, what kind of things do you enjoy singing in your private time in your home?
Well, I do sing at home. Lots of times I have music that I have to learn. So I'm singing that I have to. I'm singing music theater pieces. If I have an audition, you know, they'll send me sides, things I have to learn. I have to learn music for my church job, so I'll work on that. But if I'm singing for my own pleasure, I like Stephen Sondheim. I like Stephen Sondheim a lot. I sing Mozart. I sing Handel. I have, you know, I sing the old Italian art songs because I feel like they're good practice. So I sing a lot at home, and I have my favorite pieces that I feel like are pieces of music that get my voice into good condition. So I do exercises, you know, vocalises, but then I have specific pieces of music that I'll sing because they set up my voice well. And, you know, one piece is called Il Gelsomino by Handel, and that means the jasmine. Son Gelsomino, son picciol fiore. You know, it's just, I am the jasmine, I'm a little tiny flower. So that's the translation. And, you know, there are a lot of pieces like that, because I've been singing a long time. Did that answer it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thanks, Aaron. Thank you. Thank you.
Hello.
And you are?
Cody Jones.
Cody Jones.
That's the one.
That's a good name.
Thanks.
Cody Jones. Hell yeah.
Yeah. So we managed to steal part of my question. I'll just let this. What do you use to warm up your voice?
Well, I do a lot of funny exercises. My favorite is yang, 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 yang. It is spelled N-Y-A-N-G. And all of my voice students know, I say, you know, if they're returning after a year, because I teach at this theater training school called Kids Stage, and I say, okay, who remembers my favorite word? Nyang. So that's a favorite. And then lip trill, which a lot of voice teachers use. Because the point of doing a lip trill is if my air stream stops, nothing happens. Mm-hmm. So doing the lip trill is a good check on whether you are continuing to send up a steady stream of air. So I like the lip trill, I like nyang, I like ba baby bo boo. Ba baby bo ba baby bo boo. I like that. A lot of vowels. I like your regular arpeggios. Z z z za. And I like scales. Z z z z za. Which is up to 11, and then you come back down 9-7. 6-5,
421, I think it is. I'd have to work it out on a keyboard. I'm not, you know, I wasn't expecting to be talking about vocal pedagogy tonight. But I do V-V-V-V-8531. V-V-V-V-V-V-V-V-V-V-V-V-V-V-V-V-V. Because I find that it's actually easier to sing higher notes if you start on them. You open up the right way. And then I do staccato exercises. Zoo, zoo. That wasn't very good. Zoo,
zoo. It was perfect.
That was better.
That was perfecter.
Staccato exercises, I wouldn't recommend them for the male voice so much, but they're really good for the female voice. It gets the gut working, you know, and it also warms up your upper voice without having to sustain. Because the last thing you want to do in the warm-up is sustaining high notes. I mean, I have a lot of exercises that I do. Exercises that I like for young men, I do a falsetto exercise where I really ask the young man to start in his falsetto, young man.
Did I open up a can of worms? Yeah. That's a bad question.
You did. You did. Hang
on. Oh, good. I probably shouldn't ask the second one now, should I?
So what I want you to do...
My throat is kind of messed up.
Ooh, ah. So I want you to do the first three notes in your falsetto and then drop into your full voice on the bottom note. So this actually are these are the pitches I want you to match. Ooh, ah.
Didn't do the final part.
So, it's very nice because you did the whole exercise in your falsetto. I want you to do it again, and I want you to do it again. I want you just to do the first three notes in your falsetto, and then I want you to feel your voice break, and I want you to go into your full voice.
Goody.
So... Yes. Yes, yes. Now, the reason that I have you, how old are you?
I'm 18.
Yeah. I have students back in Seattle your age. I have seniors in high school, guys, you know, who are 18. I'm getting them ready for college. When the male voice goes through the big change, which, you know, can be 12 years old, up to like 14 years old, sometimes as late as 15, but a lot of times young men, because the voice is going up and down and up and down and up and down and doesn't settle, they lose a connection to their falsetto. Because when, before puberty, the young boy just sings in a falsetto. So often these young male voices after puberty can't remember how to get to their falsetto. And in the kind of music that I teach, music theater, all young men need to be able to use their falsetto because that music calls for it. So I do this exercise with all my young male students so that they feel how they open up for their falsetto. Then I will have them do this, you know, so you start on a high C, you did a high C in your falsetto. Then I'll have you do an exercise, the same thing, 8531, let me just, I don't know what's happening.
Now or later?
No, I'm gonna have you do it, hang on.
Goody.
Hang on. So now what I want you to do is start on this note, and I can't do it this low, but just Nah. So 8531, but in that octave. So this is an octave lower. Nah. And then go to the low C, which I don't have because I don't have that note. So, nah.
Nah.
Bottom octave.
Nah.
Yes. Do it again. So do it again.
Nah.
Good job. Now go up to this note. Nah.
One more time.
Nah.
Nah.
Now go to this note. Nah.
Nah.
Yes. So after you've done the falsetto exercise and you've really opened up for those high notes, then you do this exercise, 8531, in your full voice. Go up to the top of your range, try to stay in full voice. When you flip over into your falsetto, that's fine. Just turn the corner and come back down in your full voice, because your range at 18, your range is still changing, and your range is probably different every day. You have a very nice voice.
Thank you.
You have a very nice voice. So I hope you're studying. Are you singing in an ensemble?
I'm not. It's called my room.
So are you still in high school?
No, I've already graduated.
Uh-huh. Are you studying now? Are you working? What are you doing?
I'm working for right now until I decide what I really want to do. That would go into my second question.
Okay, so the same advice that I gave to Amanda, you need to get into a singing ensemble. Amanda's already in one. You need to be in a singing ensemble that's making you sing every week. I don't care if it's a religious organization or a community chorus or a show choir, but you need to be doing it every week, and they will be very happy to have you because you have a very nice voice. And not that many men do it, but that will improve your musicianship and improve your singing. So if you love to sing, do it. And if you want to come by my table later in the dealer room, I'll talk to you more about it and I'll give you some ideas. Okay?
So the second part of this has to do with... I didn't decide this, I'm sorry. The second part of this has to do with the fact that I was there earlier. I talked to your partner and he mentioned about getting started in voice acting. Just try, get your voice out there and whatnot, and that he'll have a panel tomorrow where I can ask him the question in more detail.
Yes, and he doesn't digress the way I do. You know. So.
What would you suggest now that you've said that you don't digress what you do?
Mr. Cody?
Yes.
What would I suggest?
Yes.
Singing. Because singing trains your voice and singing trains your ear. And those skills are invaluable. I mean, they've been invaluable to me because, you know, all my voice training was for singing. And I really know how to use my voice and I really know how to take care of my voice.
That second part is my problem, it seems, but go on.
Well, yes, ultimately you want to get a voice demo, and you can sit at home with, you know, some kind of recording, what are they called?
Walkman?
No, not Walkman. You know, they're called, like, Guitar Band or something like that. You can just record your voice.
Oh, recording software.
Yeah, recording software. That's the word I was looking for. Software. That's a new word for me. But just record your voice. I'd love some water, but I don't know if I can get any. Just
cool over there.
Try. Oh, there is some over there. Maybe I'll go. Oh. Somebody's helping me. Thank you.
You're so kind.
Thank you.
Clapping away from the mic. I'm going to personally apologize to everyone behind me.
Hang on, just wait, just wait. I told you that you were one of my personal heroes and inspirations, and you called me beautiful. I don't know if you remember.
Well, yes, I do.
I just.
But you're.
Yes, it is. You're very
What's
sweet.
That? You can give it. Which one is that?
So there's. I've got a tip. I'll come see your deal later.
Okay, and voice of the reason.
So the only thing I'm trying to say is you need to experiment with different voices and record yourself and listen to them and see if they come out the way that you expected. Because what I find with younger people is you don't really know what you sound like. I mean, for me, when I first heard my recorded sound, it was like, God, do I sound like that? And you get used to it after a while. It's like, oh, okay. And then you learn how to recreate it. But, you know, any experimentation you can do on your own, voice acting, you guys, acting. That's the important word, not voice, acting. So you should get yourself into an acting class.
I'd plan.
And they're all over the place. All right. Okay, Cody. Thank you, Cody.
So this isn't a music question. one of my favorite parts of Pacific Rim was when I suddenly realized that it's GLaDOS who's voicing Gypsy Danger. Is there anything you can tell us about, you know, there's been an announcement of a sequel. Is there anything you can tell us about Gypsy Danger coming back, or?
Listen, I sacrificed myself to save the world the last time. I have heard nothing. I don't know if I don't think they're going to bring Gypsy Danger back. I wouldn't. I mean, I saved the world. You know, what do you expect? I have no idea. I've not been contacted. My agent has not been contacted. If there wants to be a hue and cry saying, oh my God, you can't do Pacific Rim 2 without Ellen McLain, I would not gainsay you. but no, I've heard nothing. I've heard nothing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
And you are?
Zach.
Zach. Okay.
I apologize if this question has already been answered, but do you have a specific favorite quote or moment from Portal or Portal 2?
Well, I do like when, you know, she's sort of resuscitated in Portal 2, but then I also like, you know, killing you and giving you good advice aren't mutually exclusive. The rocket really is the way to go. And I think that's a good line. I like that. That, you know, even though I, you know, I might kill you, you really should listen to me because I have good advice. It's true.
All right. Thanks.
Well, you're welcome. Thank you, Zach.
You're welcome.
Hello.
And you are?
My name is EJ.
Hi, EJ.
Hello. My question was, first off, I'm a big fan of your work, voice and singing. I'm a big fan of Valve, most of what they, all of what they do.
Most, some, all.
Pretty much all of it. My question is, when you were on the set of Portal and Portal 2, and even TF2, did you get a chance to work with any of the other voice actors or crew members? Like, basically what I'm asking is, were there any behind-the-scenes stories with Stephen Merchant and J.K. Simmons and even Gabe Newell himself?
Well, you know, I have never met Gabe Newell. John and I were invited to the Dota International in August, because John's the announcer voice for it in Seattle. And I saw him in Key Arena. I was up in a box and he was down in the middle of the floor. I'm sure he didn't know I was there, but I saw him. I've never met him. And for Stephen Merchant and J.K. Simmons, I was in the recording studio in Seattle. They played recordings of them for me. We never worked together. So I never met Stephen Merchant or J.K. Simmons, but they played lines that they recorded. Stephen Merchant was recorded in London, and I think J.K. Simmons was recorded in L.A. And so they played recordings for me. But you see, when a voice actor is hired, say I'm hired for an hour session, or a two-hour session, or even at the most 4 hours, they don't want me standing around for half that time listening to somebody else talk. They want me talking the whole time, or any voice actor. They want to be recording that voice actor the whole time so they get their money's worth. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
A bit random, but do you ever hear the State Farm commercials come on the TV and say, oh, hey, I was in a game with that guy?
Well, I mean, I don't know which State Farm commercial you're speaking of. Is this with J.K. Simmons or with...
Yeah.
It is? Well, listen, J.K. Simmons is a wonderful, wonderful actor. And I do think, well, we're on the same game. I would love to meet him. I think, actually, I would love to meet him more than Stephen Merchant. Because, and this is going to sound funny, but because J.K. Simmons is, you know, from the same country, and his experience as an actor is more sort of what I've done. Stage work, some film. He's done lots of film. And we're about the same age. J.K. Simmons and I are about the same age. And I am very impressed with his work. And what was the film where he did, you know, he was the drum teacher? Oh, God. Wasn't he scary? And, you know, people have talked to me about that film because I teach music. And I would say, I would fire that person. I would never let that person teach music to young people. Maybe adults, if they know what they're getting into, but I think that is a counterproductive, cruel, sadistic way to teach that was depicted in that movie. Although the movie was brilliant. And he was brilliant. Anyway, that's what I think about J.K. Simmons.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hello, sir.
Hello again. Robert.
Yes, Robert, the artist.
Yep. So something that I come across a lot as doing role-playing games and a little bit that I talked with you before, one of the fun things is always coming across and doing accents. What accents have you used or would you like to use or do you find to be fun to emulate
Well, I think we told you that John and I just finished a production of My Fair Lady, and I played this little character called Mrs. Hopkins, and she said, oh, you're a lucky man, Alfie Doolittle. Fallen into a tub of butter you have. Ah, we're round father, and he don't know. Moved in with a swell Eliza is. Left here in a taxi all by herself, smart as paint, and ain't been home for 3 days. And then I gets a message from her this morning. She wants a thing sent over to 27A Wimpole Street, care of Professor Higgins. And what things does she want? A birdcage and a Chinese fan. But, she says, never mind about sending any clothes.
I think Rex Harrison would have definitely loved to have met you.
That's a fun one. That's a fun one to do. And it was fun acting on stage with my husband. So that was fun.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Robert.
Hi.
Hi.
My name is Laura.
Hello, Laura.
It's nice to meet you. I also work as an opera singer, and I was curious. There's one thing I've heard some teachers say that is the way you speak in just natural conversation can have an influence on the way your singing voice sounds. Like, soprano should speak high and mezzo should speak low. Do you think there's any worth to that? And have you found that the timbre of your singing voice has changed as a result of doing so much voice work?
Well, but I agree with that idea. I find that most people in this country speak too low, and I'm speaking of males and females, because we really should speak up like this. I'm a soprano. I should speak up here all the time. I don't. I'm called upon to do other things. But if I'm teaching my young voice students to sing, one last kiss before the da, one last kiss and farewell. If they're saying, okay, now say the words in rhythm. One last kiss before the ball, one last kiss and farewell. That doesn't help them. But if they say, one last kiss before the ball, one last kiss and farewell, one last kiss and farewell. Do you hear that I'm placing my speaking voice really where I'm going to be using it singing? And it does. I mean, I don't speak the same way. After all these years of singing and teaching voice, it has affected my speech, and I think I speak in a healthier way than I used to. So, if you are a singer, you should be careful. Has everybody heard about vocal fry?
Yes.
Yeah, vocal fry. It's kind of a trendy, kind of a popular thing right now. I have a friend, she's almost as old as I am, and she's a pediatrician, and she uses vocal fry all the time because she's many times, and I know why, she's speaking to male physicians, and she feels if she doesn't lower her voice, they're not going to take her seriously. Which is very unfortunate, because if you listen to the way people speak Spanish, Spanish is really well placed, and it's all up here. Me gustan todos, en general. It's, you know, it's up here, and that's a great place. And most people who have Spanish as their first language sing very easily and naturally, because the language places their voice. English, it's all back and down and low. So the way you speak does affect the way you sing. And the longer you study, the more conscious you become of when you're speaking incorrectly. So, I mean, did that answer
yes,
your
it
question?
Did. Thank you.
Well, you're
thanks
welcome,
so much.
Laura. Hello.
Hi. I'm here to end the trend of normal-sounding names. I'm Yotes.
Yotes?
Mm-hmm.
How do you spell that?
It's Y-O-T-E-S.
Y-O-T-E-S. That's a wonderful name.
Mm-hmm. And my question for you is, do you ever use your voice acting or singing talents for evil? Like, let's say, like, ordering a pizza, going through the drive-thru, leaving a voicemail for somebody? Ever use it for fun?
I use it sometimes to intimidate my students. It was funny, I teach on Mondays, and what holiday. It was actually Martin Luther King Jr. Day, and my school decided to teach anyway because we're an after-school program, and one of my students thought that he wouldn't have school today because it is, you know, that day, it is a national holiday. And so another kid in the class had me make a you know, a Snapchat thing or a little recording telling him that he had missed class. So I use it to intimidate my students sometimes. But I hope that's not for evil.
Oh, it's their students.
Did you have another question, Yotes?
Yeah, actually.
Go ahead.
I'm wondering.
I mean, some people have been up here for years,
yeah,
you know?
Just chatting it like, up. Like, go
Cody Jones.
Later.
Cody Jones, where are you?
I'm wondering, like, my heart is pumping up right here, and I have no reason to be nervous since you're, like, the nicest voice actress I've ever seen. And I'm wondering, like, are there people you would get nervous to talk to?
I am 63, which I said before. I don't get so nervous meeting people anymore. I bet you I'd be nervous if I met President Obama. I bet you I'd be nervous. For him, I'd probably be nervous, but then, of course, all the Secret Service agents would be, you know, looking at me.
Nervous
and,
for different reasons.
And, but I have gotten to the point, I get nervous in auditions. You know, I have never done an audition where I wasn't nervous because I have to audition all the time because I'm auditioning for, you know, voice. I don't get nervous at home when I'm making a recording, but a live theater audition, I get nervous. But I have come to the realization that I'm curious about everyone I meet, and we're all human beings. And, you know, I would feel nervous if I felt like I was, you know, in danger of offending someone. I wouldn't want to offend anybody. But I don't think I would get nervous meeting anybody. You know, if I did get an opportunity to meet J.K. Simmons, I got an opportunity a few years back to meet Mark Hamill, you know, Luke Skywalker. And I wasn't nervous, but I was excited. And he was so gracious and so friendly, and he introduced me to his wife. And, you know, we two are about the same age, and he was just so friendly. So, you know, at this point, when you get a few years under your belt, it's like, you know, we all have to put our pants on one leg at a time. So I don't get nervous like that anymore.
But, inspirational, thank you.
Well, thank you, Yotes. Thank you.
Okay, to keep things interesting, I'm also a mic.
Another mic, okay.
Anyway, you mentioned teaching high school students. Have any of your students had any interesting reactions to having GLaDOS for a teacher?
Oh, they think it's a hoot. No, and some of them, and I have to say it's the guys who actually think it's pretty good. And you know what the young women do. if they have someone that they want to impress, they'll come in and they'll say, Ellen, can I get your autograph on something? I say, sure, here's a headshot. And, you know, I sign it to, you know, some friend of theirs that they think will be impressed by that. And it's like, you know, easy for me. But I have a student right now. I've had him for like 5 years. Some of these kids started with me when they were in seventh grade, and now they're like, you know, juniors and seniors in high school. So I've had him for a while, and they make fun of me all the time. They think I'm funny, and I guess I am. And then I have to get really gruff and say, okay, now listen to me. I know what I'm talking about. Oh, yeah, Ellen. You know, so sometimes they take me seriously, but sometimes they just, you know, like to make jokes with me. And because I'm kind of old news, you know, Mike? It's like, oh, yeah, you know, 5 years ago they were impressed that I was GLaDOS, but now I'm just Ellen. So, but we have a great time. I love teaching people how to sing because it's so much fun. You know, singing is just fun. And if singing isn't fun, then you shouldn't be doing it. Or you have, or you've had the wrong teacher. You should come study with me. Well, did you have another question, Mike?
That was it. Interesting.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Oh, boy. My name's Kevin Dineros.
Say it again.
My name is Kevin Dineros.
Kevin, nice to meet you. Dineros.
Nice.
How are you?
I'm tired-ish.
Yeah.
Got school tomorrow. What do you expect?
Well, what are you studying?
Well, I'm in high school, so, not music, why not?
Well, you have a wonderful low voice.
Thank you. Knowing that I've done some baking here and there, and I've tried to make a living off of it, when I was...
Say that again, that you've done some...
I've baked when I was younger.
Oh, uh-huh.
And one night, I decided to watch a playthrough of Portal 1. And I wanted to follow along with that cake recipe that you were talking about. And then I got too confused as I like looked into it. It's like, is that supposed to be in there? So are those actually the ingredients needed to make that cake?
Eric,
or is that
Roll
entirely
Paul.
A lie?
Eric, it's a lie. You don't, you shouldn't trust GLaDOS. You know, when I was recording Portal, Eric Wolpaw, I mean, you know, when I first went to the session, I didn't even know it was for a computer game. I wasn't even sure what it was for. But then I was recording, and I said, I don't understand. What am I saying here? And Eric Wolpaw said, okay, you're lying now. You're lying to the player. Oh, okay, I get. Why am I lying to the player? Because I thought that I was just a prompt, you know, just to help the player get through the game. And initially, that is what GLaDOS does. GLaDOS helps the player start the game. But then at a certain point, GLaDOS starts lying to the player. And that's what confused me. Because I didn't know that was going to happen. And then when I had to do that cake recipe, which is just god-awful.
Did it require for some fish, I think, was it?
Yes. Yeah. But you know, the cake that they based it on, there's a bakery in Kirkland, and there was a, you know, sort of a Bavarian chocolate cake that they based that cake on that is actually a good cake.
With fish inside?
No. It's the one that's pictured at the end.
Black Forest cake, was it?
Yeah.
Yes. That is all for my questions. Thank you.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello, what's your name?
My name is Tristan.
Tristan.
So originally
the
I
was- Wagnerian.
What?
Have you listened to Tristan und Isolde?
Nope.
The Wagner opera?
No, I haven't actually.
Oh, you should.
But originally I was going to ask the question of what was it like to work with J.K. Simmons and Stephen Merchant, but coincidentally the person asked it ahead of me,
mm-hmm.
word for word.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to think up a question while in line, and I was thinking of, have you ever applied for any roles that you never actually like ended up getting in the end?
Oh yeah, lots of them.
Which ones were they?
Well, those are the ones you don't remember. But when I did auditions for the Dota 2 voices, so I'm Broodmother and Death Prophet in Dota 2, but I must have auditioned for 8 other characters that I didn't get. And if I saw their names listed, I might remember. Oh, yeah, I auditioned for that one. And it was so funny. I sent in all these auditions, and it really took me a long time because I auditioned for like 10 different characters. And Bill Van Buren saw me at a recording session for something else, and he said, well, Ellen, yeah, we liked all your auditions, but we're saving you for something a little bit more poisonous. And I said, poisonous, okay. But then I got to do the big spider, you know. Mother knows best. You know, I liked being the big spider. So, there are a lot of things I haven't gotten. I've not gotten more things than I've gotten. But that's about auditioning. You know, that's any actor. is you audition and audition and audition, and sometimes you get the work. Was that what you wanted to know?
Yeah, that's pretty much the satisfying answer, I guess.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, my name's Lucas.
Hi, Lucas.
So, going towards more the musical theater side, what has always been a dream role for you and why?
Well, many of the dream roles I never got to play. I did My Fair Lady on Broadway back in 1981, and I would have loved to have played Eliza, but I was in the chorus. And I never did get to play Eliza, and this last production that my husband and I did, of course I was Mrs. Hopkins and the Queen of Transylvania, but our Eliza was this beautiful young woman named Allison Standley, who was fabulous. So, you know, you get these ideas about roles that you'd like to play that you never do. But then, you know, a few years back, there's a show called The Full Monty, and it's a musicalization of a movie, a British film, about five steel workers who do a strip act to make money because they've been fired. And I played a role in that named Jeanette. And I was this old chain-smoking piano player. And, oh my God, you know, she sang, "This gig's an echo of that time with Buddy Greco when we played the Desert Inn in 59. The drummer was a junkie," you know, and like that. And I never thought that I'd get to play that role, and I got to, and it was great fun. So, you know, John just got to play Alfie Doolittle in My Fair Lady. That was one of his dream roles. But I don't worry about that so much. Susanna in The Marriage of Figaro was a dream role that I got to play more than once. Mimi in La Boheme, I never thought I'd get to play that role. I did. I loved doing that. So I've gotten to do a lot of different parts that weren't dream roles to begin with, but ended up being, you know, just great fun. Great fun. Clarie in Steel Magnolias. Wonderful. You know, I get to say things like, "I love you more than my luggage." So, you know, fun stuff. Well, you're welcome, Lucas. You may pick that up. Yes, you may. You're so tall. Go ahead.
Well, first off, you were talking about how you didn't like deep voices, so I apologize. You'll have to bear with me.
No, I do like deep voices, if that really is your voice. Now, my husband has a very deep voice, but if you're a soprano, and you talk like this.
Doesn't get much higher than this.
That's not good. That's fine. Do you sing in any group?
No.
You should. You know, my husband just got hired for a gig because he's got a low B flat.
Did a musical once, won't do it again.
What musical did you do?
Joseph, an Amazing Technicolor.
Yes. Yes. Were you one of the brothers?
Yes. So the question.
I bet
questions.
You had fun.
Two questions I have to ask. Number one, from my sister, who is not attending. Mm-hmm. She is dead set on becoming an opera actress, and she would like to know what type of institutes she should apply to. I know she's applying to the Opera Institute, the National Opera Institute. Do you have any kind of advice?
So how old is your sister?
She is 14.
Okay, so she's really young. She's really young. Places that she could go to school now, she could go to Interlaken, mm-hmm. and that's a high school for the arts. There's, of course, a high school for the arts in New York, the North Carolina School of the Arts, where I went for voice and my sister went for ballet. That takes people that young. But mainly, does she have a voice teacher?
Yes. Who does she? I said, as far as I'm aware, I do not know the specifics of her education.
Well, and where does she live? What city?
Fredericksburg.
Well, but how great that she lives close to a major metropolitan area. She can go to the Washington Opera and hear, because it's important for her to hear a lot of opera, not just recordings, but to go to live opera. So she can go to the Washington Opera and she can, you know, hop on the train and go up to New York and go to the Met and see things, watch the Met live broadcasts, because they're in, you know, movie theaters around, you know, they'll play them in movie theaters, but live performances. I mean, she needs to be taking a voice lesson every week. Does she play an instrument?
Piano.
Yes. Because that's actually what I started on. I started piano lessons when I was 6.
Me too.
And it's good.
But I quit it, unfortunately.
Well, but you know how to read music.
Mm-hmm. Went on to violin.
It's, well, good. Are you still playing the violin?
Yes, now for 13 years.
You know, violin is a very good instrument for singers, because piano, you're just basically hitting a key and that's the note. But violin really is a better training for your ear, because you have to hear the note correctly before you can play it. The piano, if it's in tune, you play the right note. She needs to continue with her piano, because she wants to always be able to teach herself her music, because it gets prohibitively expensive if she has to pay somebody. Like Luciano Pavarotti, he could read music, but he always paid someone to teach him his music. And your sister doesn't want to do that. She wants to be able to learn her music on her own. If she doesn't go to an art school in high school, then of course, you know, the schools that I recommend, Indiana University has a great program, vocal program in Bloomington, Indiana. I went to New England Conservatory in Boston. They have good voice teachers there. Manhattan has very good voice teachers. Juilliard is very cutthroat. I actually wouldn't recommend Juilliard. The University of Arizona has a very good program. Michigan, the University of Michigan has a very good program. Carnegie Mellon is good. Cincinnati Conservatory is excellent. And schools kind of go in waves where, you know, sort of the high points of the faculty that they have. Cincinnati Conservatory is really high up there now for singers. But that's gonna be for college. Right now, she's very young. She needs to keep her piano up. She needs to take her voice lessons. And it won't hurt her to audition for musicals, even if though you just did one. Don't discourage your sister.
She's auditioned to many, and she's done many.
Yeah, but that's good, because musicals are what she's prepared to do at 14. There aren't many operas that she can do at her young age, but musicals are great experience for being on stage and singing. Is that helpful?
Yes. And I had one other very short question.
Uh-huh.
This pertains more to the robotics side.
Okay.
Aside GLaDOS, do you have a favorite robot in fiction?
Hal. Dave.
I'm afraid I can't do that.
Thank you. Thank you. And please give my regards to your sister.
Hi, my name is Cody, and I'm a game programmer.
And tell me your name again.
Cody.
Cody. Another Cody.
I don't sing, though.
You say that.
No, I just want to write code all day. I was wondering if there are any moments in any of the games you worked on where your voice work like actually changed the direction of the design of the game.
Well, on Portal 2, when I started recording for Portal 2, I don't know if it was my voice work that changed it, but Jay Pinkerton and Eric Wolpaw really rewrote the whole thing. I mean, that game changed, because I recorded for that game over a period of 10 months, going in at least every 2 weeks, and I would go in and do copy, and then I'd come back in 2 weeks, and everything would be different. Because what I had been told is, when I recorded Portal, they already had created the game, they just needed to plug in my voice, and they already knew what the character was going to say. But for Portal 2, none of the developers wanted to work with sort of a stand-in voice. They only wanted to work with my voice. So I kept recording copy, and as the game went along, it kept changing. And so I don't know if I directly affected that, but I was affected by that, because I just kept pouring out more copy and more copy and more copy.
That's very interesting. Thank you.
You're welcome. Hello, Nathan.
Hello again, Ellen. I have two questions. First question. Outside of the classical genre of music that you usually prefer to sing, is there any other genres that you like say pop or rock, anything like that?
Well, I'm not a very good rock singer.
Oh, come on.
I'm just not. The song that I always used, if they wanted to hear something, you know, soft rock, I would always do The Rose, you know, the Amanda McBroom. Some say love, it is a river that drowns the tender reed. That's the song I would always do. And then, you know, it's just... music theater is what is my field of expertise, and opera. And I've always done a little bit of, you know, I'd sing some Beatles songs, and, you know, I would work on anything that people wanted me to work on, but I know what my voice does best, and that's opera and music theater. So, you know, I'm not Grace Slick or, you know, the wonderful Janis Joplin. You know, I suppose if anybody, I could sing like anybody, it would be, who was the Canadian lady? She's been ill recently. And she, born with the moon in Cancer, Joni Mitchell. You know, Joni Mitchell, I could probably sing like her. And of course, when I was young, I loved Judy Collins. And I sang things that she sang because I loved her voice. Does that answer that question?
Well, yes, that answers that first question. Now for the second one,
Seeing
as how you're a fan of Mozart, are you familiar with the magic flute?
Yes, I am.
All right, and are you familiar with Der Holy Rock?
With what?
Der Holy Rock. That was the song from The Queen of Midnight.
Oh, The Queen of the Night.
Oh, yeah, Queen of
the
Night.
The Queen of the Night. Da 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 da.
That one. Can you actually sing it?
Well, no, I can't. Because the aria that I always did from that was Pamina's aria, Ach, ich fühl's, because Pamina's a lyric soprano, and I did some coloratura, but mainly I was a light lyric soprano. So Pamina's aria I used many times in audition, but I never sang the Queen of the Night arias. They're very difficult to sing.
Yes, they are. All right, that'll do it for me. Thank you
very
much.
Okay, well, thank you, Nathan. Let's see. All right, I'm going to request at this point that nobody else get in line, because I was supposed to finish this at 8:30. And I think somebody's coming to tell me that I need to get out of here. Okay. You are the last question, and the three of you in line will meet out in the hall, and I'll answer your questions.
No pressure on me or anything.
Okay, so yours is the last question.
All right. Well, it's a short one, so my name's Christina, by the way.
Lucia?
No, Christina.
Christina. Yeah. Hello.
And my question is, because you said that you love singing Sondheim and that you've done stage work, so I was just wondering what some of your favorite plays or musicals are, either ones that you've been in or just...
Well, my favorite Sondheim show is A Little Night Music. Mm-hmm. And the favorite Sondheim song that I like to sing at present is Children Will Listen. I love that song. It's about teaching. I think it's a great song. I think My Fair Lady came out in 1956. It was the pinnacle of American music theater. And then when West Side Story came out the next year. So my five favorite musicals are...
Okay.
Frank Lesser's Guys and Dolls, My Fair Lady, you know, Lerner and Lowe, West Side Story, Leonard Bernstein, A Little Night Music, Leonard Bernstein. What did I say? What was the last one? Little Night Music, Stephen Sondheim, West Side Story.
You said West Side Story.
I said that. Guys and Dolls, My Fair Lady, West Side Story, A Little Night Music, and The Music Man,
yes.
Meredith Wilson. Those are my five favorite musicals.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you, Christina. Thank you all so much. Thank you. So, John's doing a panel tomorrow at 3:30, and we're doing Voice of Palooza tomorrow night at 10 o'clock with Wes Johnson. There'll be a lot of improv and fun. So hope to see you all again. Thank you.